it up now. So. You're live right now.
Are we live right now?
You are.
Are we live right now? Cool. We're live, right?
We're live.
Good. We're live.
Three. Two. One.
We're live. Hurry up, everyone. Just waiting for you to get here, okay? Thank you, man. Appreciate it. Can you jump right?
No.
Me either. Prez, you want to grab one of those cool posters so we can just hold it up and show people, please?
All right, can I have everybody at the table to come up and sit down for us? Could that nice old guy in the black shirt come up here when he gets a sec, please? He's fairly important to this deal.
I'm glad I got to see you here.
It isn't time, B-Dub. You can sit up here for a second if you want. I promise the flowers are being moved. Thank you. Do you want to hold it up here and show people watching online what that looks like? So I think we've only got about 150 of those left, if that. So make sure today you stop by and buy one off Jack for $20 and get him to sign it, and that will look amazing in a frame. So for those that are watching on Facebook Live, I hope the audio is going to be okay for you. Obviously it's not ideal, this situation, but I'm hoping that you'll be able to hear it okay, and you can fire a couple questions at us if you want. Mr. Hewitt, when you're ready. I'll start with this. I'm not even going to try and explain what's going to happen in the next hour because I have no idea myself. I thought I could plan for it, but then what was the point of that? He doesn't know what he's going to say, and I don't know what I'm going to say either, so.
As long as it's all politically correct.
Oh, very politically correct.
Yeah.
If we didn't have Facebook Live, I'm pretty sure Jack would say anything. I had to get him to back off a little bit on that.
There's where the fun is, though.
I know. Did you hear his invocation last night? When he catches invocation, scared the heck out of me. He's the best advertisement for my moonshine, isn't he?
Yeah.
See him wandering over with that methanol moonshine shirt. It literally looks like he's been drinking moonshine all day. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Hewitt. So, let me give that to you, Eric, real quick. So, before we get started, no, I didn't bring you flowers. Candy's Flower Shop in Knoxville here in the square is an amazing, beautiful flowering gift center. You're staying above that at the moment. There's a card here and it says, to not the most famous Hewitt, but definitely the most important. So there's a lady sitting down the back there who's going to walk up towards me now. She's like, oh, God. What do you call her? Arlene? Her name is Jody, by the way, but he calls her Arlene.
Her name's Arlene, too. It's Jody Arlene.
What does she prefer?
Jody.
Arlene?
So, can you even imagine what this incredible woman's life is like? This is Jody Hewitt, everybody. Would you please put your hands together for this amazing lady? So, these are for you, by the way. And they should travel really nicely in the car, in the truck tomorrow.
She walks like...
Hey, I'm going to turn you on. The worst that is happening on you.
She walks, turn that baby on. She walks like me too when she drinks on the and that's quite often.
Do you wonder why she might drink, Jack?
Just mouth and alcohol don't go together.
Tony Bockhoven, really cool to have you here. Tony, come up here for a sec. Voice of the Knoxville Raceway for the last 25 years. Must have started when he was 10, right, Jack? We had Tony, good having you, mate.
Good morning,
yeah. Well, if you had an earring, Jack would kiss you. You could bet on that. Tony, tell me when I say Jack Hewitt to you, what that means to you.
He was one of the most badass race car drivers when race car drivers were men.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say nice guy, but apparently you were a badass race car driver.
Well, you know, I don't know if you ever watched the movie Happy Days, but when Richard Cunningham started getting a fight with the guy, he's acting all bad in a hamburger shop. Marianne Fondy said, sometime in there, you had to get in a fight. Richie said, this is not a good time to tell me this. Well, luckily I got in a fight, so I didn't have to fight a lot, but the reputation just always got better.
Absolutely. Did you get to call any of his racing, Tony?
I think maybe right when I first started I did, and then when I announced the Chili Bowl when he was driving the two-seater a couple times, of course I talked about that at length.
I was there for that.
How I begged Emmett many times, just let me ride just once.
No, you'll probably flip it, and then you won't be able to announce.
Did you ever flip it?
Yeah, my boy, I let him when he was 16. I wanted him to drive against Dad, you know, because I got to race against my dad. And he was 16, and Jody and I went to that. We'll put him in a Terre Haute at an open show. And I don't know, something broke in my car in the heat race, and he wasn't, you know, 16 just starting. He missed the show, so he actually started ahead of me to be me. And when the red came out, I knew who it was. I just didn't know where it was. And he flipped the big old school bus outside the park at Terre Haute. But I never did.
Tony, you and I, we talk a lot about characters in the sport and how important they are to the job that you and I do. It's kind of sad that this is an era I don't think we'll ever see again.
No, you know, back then, watching Hewitt race, you know, he could take a car that wasn't great and make that thing fast and run it hard and race hard. And at the end of the day, it was all about racing. And if maybe you bumped wheels, okay, you bumped wheels, but it wasn't nothing personal. He was just out there to win. And there's a lot of political racing that goes on today, and that's probably one of the things that, you know, as we get older, we'll miss more, right? Is that when guys like Jack were making a living racing, it was all about eating tomorrow. And he had to race as hard as he could tonight so that he could eat the next day.
Was that why you got peed off at some guys, because they took away your food for the next day?
No, I had anybody that I got in a fight with in racing, they crashed me the first time, that's racing. You just got to take that. But now you do it again in the next month or something like that, I'm going to stop you from running into my race car. I can't do the whole field, but I'm going to stop you from running into my car.
Isn't it special to have him here, Tony? Like, last night he did the invocation. I got to admit, I was a little nervous. But the crowd just erupted, didn't they?
Yeah, I mean, it's not every day that you can have a guy like Jack Hewitt at the Late Model Knoxville Nationals. I mean, he was a badass in everything he drove. And, you know, when we had the champions of the Knoxville Nationals here a few weeks ago, some of those guys were like, oh, you know, yeah, I raced. I had some good races. But they don't really realize how a guy like me recognizes them as that they are sprint car racing to me. They were the guys that when I came to the race, I'm like, man, I hope a guy like Ron Schumann's there. You know, I hope Jack Hewitt's there. And, you know, that those kind of things. Yeah. When I saw Mike Brooks running the TMC car, it's like, okay, this is the real race, right? I mean, they made those races what they were.
Yeah?
We had the Terre Haute one time, and Don Spencer had a great private collection of race cars. He turned around, and we had a lunch going together, and Poncho Carter, Joe Saldana, Tom Bigelow, Billy Volkovich, I mean, the list just went on, along with Steve Stapp, Dave McPherson. They were just all there that day, and great Speedway Bill was there, you know, Speedway Bill.
Yeah.
And they were all there, and Schrader was there. And some lady said, aren't you Kenny Schrader? He said, yeah. He said, well, why are you here at Holiday Inn? He said, do you see all those guys in there? They were my heroes. You know, and this was Kenny Schrader, and this lady thought he was the best thing there was, and he was there just to be around all those guys.
Tell me about the fishing superstar you were telling me about, that story that from the Bass Pro competitions.
Woo Davis, I don't know if you've ever heard of him, but he was a BASS fisherman, and he won the Classic, I think, at Chicago on Lake Michigan one year. And in the winter, the Bass fishermen, they go and they rent hotels out across the country, and they call it Bass College, and they get four or five of them together, and they all get up there and give an hour or 2 hour seminar on what their specialty is, whether it's a crankbait, artificial worms, you know, just whatever the case may be. Well, my friends who's definitely sprint car fans from Illinois, they went and they seen Woo Davis out in the hallway, and they asked him, they said, Woo, you know, we fish for fun on the weekends. You fish professionally. What do you do for fun? He said, boys, he said, I was a little town in Ohio on my way to a tournament. He said, and I asked people, the lady at the desk, what do you guys do for fun here? And she said, there's a little dirt track up the road. I think it was Eldora. I'm not 100% sure of that, but I think it was Eldora. He said, I'll drive 100 miles to watch a sprint car race now, you know. And here it is. You never know who's going to be around. Ryan Newman's got Magic Johnson, Joe Montana jerseys in his basement in his house. And he's also got one of Kevin Van Dam, just a fisherman, you know, pro fisherman. And everybody wouldn't think much about that, but if you fish, it means something.
Absolutely. Tony, what does it mean to you have Jack Hewitt here for Late Model Nationals, do you think? Because when I said to him, come out to Late Model Nationals, he said to me, I don't think late model people see me as part of their world. And I said,
No, I think they absolutely do. There's not a lot of race car drivers that race so many different disciplines of dirt cars. And I think that's what makes guys like Jack really special, is he was fast in all of those disciplines of cars. And I think that's why the late model fans love it. You know, I mean, yeah, they love guys like Scott Blomquist and the guys that are really hot today, like Tyler Erb, who's so fast here. But if you've been around late model racing a while, you remember guys like Jack Hewitt. And to see them here, I think it makes these events more important when guys like Jack come to them. And so it's not every day you get to sit in a room like this where there's, 75 people here, 100 people here, and listen to a legend like this tell stories. It's unbelievable.
Well, I just got to tell you, we broke our neck twice, we had to wear a couple halos and everything. I got robbed down my neck. Everything kind of, my right side don't work, everything. For you people that can see my wrist, it's swollen up right there. Well, this is what I brought to the Knoxville's late model race. Scott Blomquist crashed me, although it broke my wrist. Only one of the few bones I got broke other than my neck. But anyway, so I get to carry arthritis around called the Scott. You know, I didn't like him before, but I definitely don't like him now.
That's right. All this is a good kind of secret that we're not going to tell anybody, Jack.
I don't care. Like I said, the reason I don't like him is I don't like the role model he is for kids. I mean, I don't care about his race, and I'll sit there and talk to him, but the projection he gives for the kids, I don't care for.
Tony, on the table over there, Joni will have a decal. Just bring it over and sort of keep it to yourself when you bring it over here. So I got to catch up with you about a month ago now in Troy, and I said to you just randomly, is that waterfall anywhere near you where you did that incredible photo of those four cars? And you said it's only a couple miles from the house. We went down there. Does everybody recall that incredible picture of the four cars on the waterfall? Yeah. Like, oh my gosh. We'll talk about role models later. Tell me about that day. For those that haven't seen it, there was the midget, the sprint car, late model. Yep, late model.
And the champ dirt car.
Yeah, the champ dirt car, all sitting on a waterfall. I thought it was in the jungle, I must admit, when I went there. It's in suburbia, Jack.
Yeah, it's like 4 miles from our house, not three. But they go kilometers down there.
He's talking about me.
But anyway, I had Bob Hampshire when I started driving for him in 85. Well, 86, his buddy had a pond that was treated, you know, with a real pretty green, the white limestone around it, and we had the hauler and the trailer there, and then we had the Silver Crown, the late model, and the wing sprint car, and it was all white 63. Beautiful picture. I love it, you know, and everybody don't know about that one. But anyway, in my mind, I was always trying to beat this picture, you know, and I thought to get all the cars painted the color, the same color at the same time with something, and then where would I go? Well, the year that we got all the cars painted the same color, and all 21s, and Mr. Hunt on most of them, on all of them, and here I thought, well, what's wrong with Ludlow Falls? And it's just right down the road. And what it is, every year they have a Christmas deal where they put lights up across the falls and the manger deal down the bottom, but it's all limestone. So anyway, we just gonna push the car down there on the falls. Well, the night before it poured down rain. Now it's not just a little waterfall, it's a gusher. And then right, we got the car down there, I don't know how long it took. It took a total of 7 hours. But when we turned around, by the time we got the car to take the picture, the gravel pit up the way, a stone quarry up there, started pumping water in because it was filling up, and the sediment changed it to a milk rather than just real pretty green. But we had a hole done it, and it's one that they won't forget too quick, I hope.
Now, I got in trouble because we did an interview live, and I asked you about it because I always told everybody, you're going to say, now, here we go again. You would assume, when you look at that picture, that that was a fairly risky situation to put four race cars on the edge of a waterfall. And I said to you, I'd been told that there was chains hanging onto the cars underneath the water. You can see the look on his face now. He's like, idiot. Right?
What would you chain it to?
Well, I don't know. But were you not worried at any point that something was going to end up at the bottom of the bathtub?
Well, the problem was that if you look at the midget tire, we got mercury on the top of all tires in the cars. And the mercury on the midget is rolled just a little bit because we put it in the biggest current there was. And it was the smallest, lightest car, and it did move a little bit, but we got her in gear and it didn't go nowhere. We didn't lose nothing there anyway. Other than our pride, because we all fell in them slick rocks and bumped our ass.
That was, I think we worked out 1991, was it thereabouts?
I think so, yeah.
30 years ago? Nobody has ever repeated a photo like that, not that I'm aware of. Nobody has ever even tried to achieve a picture like that.
Well, everybody thought it was superimposed later. And I thought, well, if you look back up in the far right-hand corner, you'll still see the four-wheeler up there. People don't superimpose four-wheelers in a picture. We got proof that ours was life. And that we had a pretty good crowd show up that day, and somebody said, oh, there's cars washing over the waterfall. Which they weren't, but it helped the crowd in.
Your brain never stops, Jack. That's one thing I've learned.
No, that's my mouth.
Well, most of the time, they're working in tandem. You think about the most profound things. Like, your brain never stops thinking about, here's what you can do with your moonshine wave. Here's what you can do with the ball. Here's what we can do with college football. Here's what we can do with flip-flops. Your brain never stops. Have you always been like that?
I don't know, but it's a curse. I mean, at night, I can be sleeping really good. If I wake up and start thinking about anything, I might as well get up because it's going to just keep going about 100 different things in different directions. And I have to get up and reset it for about an hour, and then I come back and go to bed.
Mr. Hunt, you referred to him before. Today, Mandy's dad, Denny, rolled in with a JW Strawberry King hat on. It's just amazing. I love seeing that image. It's so iconic, isn't it? We joined Jack with just a big strawberry there, and you just go, wow. What was he like?
I tell you what, he was 20 years older than we were, but he was cool. I mean, he'd get to Ohio. Once he was at the Florida State line, south, he wouldn't drink a drop of anything. But once he got north, it was all over. You know, Katie barred the door. And he would come and stay drunk, have a good time. But I think he really just didn't talk to a lot of people. So when he got drunk, he was more outgoing and forward and saying things that he would like to say. And he was a party animal, and he wanted everybody to be part of it. It wasn't like he was a selfish man, because everybody knows he gives money away. And but he was a hoot to be around. Now, the things he did, the first time we ever seen him, Charlie Schwartz introduced us, and the following year, Hemp and I over at Williams Grove, and it's raining. We said, well, let's go back home. We'll stop at Pittsburgh because we're going to run outdoor in the USAC the following night. So we get to Lernerville, and so I couldn't make the line tonight. It all paid the same. So we went there. Well, somewhere that was before cell phones. I don't know, I must have stopped and called Jody or whatever. Jody pulled in a big blue Cadillac. Cody's a year older, my son, he's a year old. Mr. Hunt's sitting in there, he's got a fifth of Jack Daniels and a case of Michelob Light. And went down there for him, paid $1,000 to win that night, and we went home with $8,000. And then on Monday, we took him to the airport. I don't remember what we did at the USAC race, but I lived 13 miles from the Dayton airport. Well, he turned around, and that's when we could go far out to the gate, you know, and he took $1,000 and just stuck it in my shirt pocket. Now, he never asked me to stay at his house or anything, because we just met, really. And I told him, I said, Mr. Hunt, I said, I thank you for this. I said, but I'm going to tell you right now, I said, when we come down to Florida in February, don't ask me to stay at your house, because I can't. And he was like half offended, you know. And it wasn't because, you know, he never asked me to stay there anyway, but since I told him I couldn't, he acted offended. He said, well, why couldn't you stay at my house? I said, I couldn't afford you to take me to the airport. He said, well, I wouldn't charge you nothing. I took $1,000, put it back in his pocket, and we became friends that day.
My face hurts already.
I can tell you what, this is one of my favorite Mr. Hunt. sort of, he's a big boy, you know, and he just, he's a big boy. And through us, we introduced him to Brent Cady. And so Brent's boys out in California, you know, everybody was always after his money or would take whatever they give him. And Mr. Hunt would test the people out there. They did a lot for him now. Good, I'm not bad nothing, but they said, well, hey, Mr. Hunt, they said, or Mr. Hunt would go, he said, hey, tie my shoes. And, yeah, well, it's right away. So they start tying his shoes. You know, just being nice because he's Mr. Hunt, you know. It wasn't that they were doing anything for no money or nothing like that, but they're just being nice to him because he will test you. And they evidently were rookies at that time. So he comes back to Ohio the following week or a couple weeks later, and he's all drunk. He says, Jack, tie my shoe. Just tie your own shoe, you fat ass. If you can't tie your shoe, buy loafers. And he still had to test it, you know. And he was just agreeing. He knew I was going to tie his shoe when they asked him. And then we left here one time going to Sedalia, Missouri to a late model race, leaving the Nationals going there. And bounce, he went the wrong way. I said, bounce, where are we at? He said, 13 miles from Nebraska. So Mr. Hunt, half drunk, half sober, he's pretty good, you know, and he's pissed because bounce got his loss. Then, of course, he had to take a shit. He went to Sedalia the next day with one sock. That was great.
Hello to everybody on Facebook Live. If you just joined us, I have no idea what we're doing, but I love it. God bless you, Jack. You are absolutely you are living proof that God has a sense of humor, mate, because you have given so many people so much joy, and it's not just what you did in a race car, it's the person that you are. That's been consistent. And if you read this book, and you have some copy, that is still available, don't you?
Yeah, Jody, she brought a couple of cases with her.
This is phenomenal. Yeah, Dave Argabright is a poet.
Yeah.
Really, he is. He's an amazing author. And some of the stories in this are just phenomenal. And it's the real deal. You wouldn't let him keep anything out. Anything you told him had to go in. Wow. Just what an incredible life you have lived, Jack.
Well, people look at me now, you know, because I landed, my right arm don't work. Well, I've been left-handed my whole life. And so, and they asked me, they said, well, how bad does this affect you, you know, with your handicap now? What handicap? I said, I've always been left-handed. I said, the only other thing I did with my right arm, I had a wristwatch on. I said, today I really don't care what time it is. I said, somebody asked, and I said, about my limp and being clumpy and everything. Some guy asked my dad one day, he said, Don, he said, did that scare your boy out there in the race car? He said, hell no. He said, you ever watch him walk? He said, take a place for him to the race car with a helmet on. So we don't have to do like this. I mean, and I tell people, Dad, if I can fix your arm in my mouth, I'll make it.
I knew it was going to be like this. So we've got a couple of questions already being asked, and I already know the answer to this one, but it's interesting that people ask it because they're going to make that comparison. Do you consider yourself the Kyle Larson of your generation, or is Kyle Larson the Jack Hewitt of his generation?
There's never been another Kyle Larson. Right now, you know, there have been Steve Kinder can drive a lot, A.J. Foyt, Mario Andretti, Tony Stewart, Kenny Schrader. I'm going to the point of saying that Kyle Larson is a racing prodigy. He's got some talent that nobody's ever had, and if they ever have another, and I hope I'm still around to see it, but no. I'd like to say I'm as good as Kyle Larson, but I was nowhere near that.
The four crown, tell me about that experience.
It was my dad said, the only thing we did wrong that day, I didn't play the lottery, because I think we would have won it. You know? We just couldn't do no wrong. It's a, you know, we used to qualify on Friday, run our heats, and then come Saturday, we'd run the 4A main, well, they'd run the B main, the main A. Well, that Friday, I qualified and went through all my heats. I didn't have to run no B mains. So we're laying up there, and I thought, I'll take a nap. Man, you're not going to do that. And we went down, and I had, we had the four cars. I had four different crews, and we went down there, and the midget was our weak suit. We started 12, and that's when the Lewis midgets were there, and the 97 Keith Coon, Keith Coons. They were there. Keith Coons. And they were all there, and we'd drive for Bob Parker Sr. Bob, we say Bobby Parker Jr., but Bob was the big part of the Parker machinery. And we come from 12th right up to win. Tracy Hines, after the race, he said, "Boy, I don't understand." He said, "I'm flat-footing Eldora right around the top, and you drive by me." But he was a kid driving sideways. We was an old fellow on the dry slick driving straight. We started 10th in the sprint car, and Dave Darlin and I had a great race, you know. At the end, he ran second. He ran third in the midgets. And then, of course, I got in the modified, and I had a John Orr and the boy. They just got one of the top modifieds at Eldora, and all our experience there. We just, you know, we just had more laps there than any of the modified drivers, fortunately for me. And we won that one. The Silver Crown, we started on the front row. And all they worried about was something breaking out because the pressure was all on them. But where it was easy for me is after we won three, nobody had ever won three there before. So I didn't care if I won the fourth one or not, you know. I was already ahead of everybody else. And when we won the fourth one, it was just unbelievable. And again, you see how the mouth is. You never know what's going to come out. And during the interview, they asked me, they said, "Well, what do you think?" I said, "You know, it's a fairy tale night." I said, "Cinderella, Snow White, you don't have anything on me tonight." And I thought that was pretty good, because that's the first time I heard it, too.
All I heard you say was a couple of reasons why you might have won. Experience, a good car. No one else had the same experience.
We had a big bag. Our McCurry tires gave it the big advantage over the Hoosier at that time.
I put it to you, all mechanical stuff aside, that there was a truly badass racing car driver who waxed the best on the planet in four different categories on one weekend. I put it to you, you just drove the wheels off everything you had and won.
I think the reason why, I was the laziest driver out there and I didn't want to have to get a job. And I was the most chicken chip because I was too scared to steal anything, so I had to go with that.
Indy, I know we're going to skip around a few topics here. The Indy 500. I want you to tell people what name was on your race car and how you changed that.
Well, I start to be AM. We did Terre Haute. We ran Terre Haute that night. The next day, I stopped at Brazil, Indiana, on the way to Indy, and I called just for the heck of it. Next morning, he said, "Man, get to Indianapolis. We want you to get in Sinden's car." Now, I didn't know anything about this. But we had to get in the Ascendant Racing car to get fitted up to take my final rookie test. I'd already taken a rookie test in IndyCar at Phoenix. But then we had to get another test because that didn't count. Well, it counts for everything other than Indianapolis. So Bob Parker and they had it all set up for me to take my rookie test at Indy in Ascendant Racing car, Jack Miller, the dentist. So I go there and they said, "Well, instead of building me a seat, they just give me Steve Kinder's seat," which that should have been fast right off the bat. And we went over and I wasn't even supposed to drive it that day, but the rain stopped, the sun came out, and we're in the garage, didn't even know it. And they said, "Would you like to go out and take a couple laps?" Well, yeah. So we took a couple laps and I did about four laps. We come in, they said, "Want to go a little faster?" I said, "Yeah, I'd love to." So we went out and they gave us 10 laps. I didn't know it. They didn't even tell me. And they come in, they said, "Well, you just completed your first phase." They said, "Can you go faster?" Well, yeah, you didn't tell me to go faster. You just had me out there riding around. So we went and did our second phase. Now, 6 o'clock, they shut the gate. When the horn goes off, they're done for the day. And Tony George and IRL let me stay, and I ran my third test that day. So I didn't quite pass all my rookie tests. I had to do that after we went to Indy. But we got with PDM, Bob Parker, the one that made it happen for me to go there in the Parker Machinery car again. He'd been a big part of my career at the end, without a doubt. And anyway, we're sitting on the top of the race car, you know, on the side, and they have my name, Jack Hewitt, on there. Well, if you ever look at any of my pictures, if it maybe late 80s or early 80s or late 80s, I guess it would be, the only one thing you see on my race car is Hewitt. Well, I'm over there talking to him. They said, "What are you doing?" So I'm scraping Jack off the car. My Indy car just had Hewitt on it.
And why was that? Because that was a reference to Dad there as well, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, they had a sticker on there, too. It said memory of Don Hewitt, you know. And shoot, it's hard to race a car when you got a tear going down your eye. Now. And that's what I thought my first couple laps on race day. You know, they pop, we made it, you know. And our dream was true, you know, and he was grinning. Everybody thought, oh, well, your dad's watching you. He loved it. I thought, I don't care. I thought, I'm going down here. I want a hug from him, you know. But it was a great day. And I've never just missed a race at Eldora for anything. My buddy's wedding or nothing, you know. I was racing. We went to the races. But that night, I didn't want the day to end. And we signed autographs till dark. So I missed the USAC race at Eldora that day.
Oh, well.
I just didn't want the day to end.
Did you have any time at all during the on-track stuff to go, holy cow, I'm doing this?
Well, what it was, is Indianapolis race is no different than running the feature at Knoxville Isle or Eldora Speedway. You know, it's a feature race. And Gary Lee said, well, Jack, what are you going to do when the race is over? I said, when the feature's over, I'm in Eldora. He got the laugh and he said, I've never heard it called a feature before. But the whole month of May is what makes the Indianapolis 500. And we turned around and we tried to do everything from the Riley Children's Hospital to anything they had going, racing for Corey, another benefit. If they had something going, we did it all, you know. And I told him, I said, you know, this is kind of like a county fair. And I said, I want to ride every ride. And we did. I mean, we didn't miss nothing that month. And like I said, it's there forever and I'll never forget it. And for me, it was really cool for Jody. And my boy got to go with us, you know. So it was a family deal, and it was just a great time, a great experience.
I think it was Mr. Murphy that commented on the interview that I did with Hemp a few weeks back. And he said that you guys were all at Hemp's shop, and you picked up the phone when it rang and said, speed costs money, how fast do you want to go? And Hemp scrambled over the table to get the phone off you and said, Jack, you can't talk to my customers like that. You can't say that stuff. So for the rest of the afternoon, any time the phone rang, he said Hemp was throwing tools, trying desperately to beat you to the phone.
Well, you don't know what you're going to say until you answer. So he just didn't trust me no more. I didn't need it.
What a relationship you had with Bob Hickshaw.
It was amazing. We went to Sharon one night, and for us it was pretty cool because we wore the same size blue jeans, same size t-shirt, same size shoes. We had both left-handed. I mean, just unbelievable, you know. And anyway, one night we left Sharon Speedway and going back to run Eldora, I think. And before I crawled up in the bunk, he always did the drive, and I was always sleeping. And I had my head down over the bunk, and I said, Amp, I said, you've always got this car so freaking tight that I can't never adjust the wing. I said, why don't you make it so I can raise the wing up and down, and then at least I can play with the adjuster a little bit. Well, by the time I got off the turnpike and crawled down to ride the rest of the way with him, he didn't have it figured out. From the time I got out of bed the next morning, it was already finished, and we won 27. He won 28 feature that year. I won 27 because Charlie Schwartz won one race in the car.
So that was the hydraulic wing. That was really the start of the hydraulic wing.
Well, it was out, but it was moving back and forth. But like I said, Hemp always had a car so tight. I told everybody it was Hemp. I said, you know, here's the deal. I did crash and flip a lot of race cars, and I got to take half the blame, you know. I said the other half went to Bob Hampshire. Unfortunately, I had to ride his out.
Tell me about your boy.
Code?
Yeah.
Well, he takes after his mother. So you know that's a problem right off the bat. But he started racing, and I don't know, things just didn't work out the way they're supposed to. He lost it. Well, then he ended up losing his arm in a motorcycle accident. A lady turned in front of him, and shoot, he got over that. He was 21. We got him back in a sprint car, and we took one of those tear-off adjusters where instead of hitting the knob on the steering wheel, he'd use his knee to use it. And he didn't run the whole year that year. But if he would have, I'd say he'd have been right up there if he wouldn't have won one. He would just made me look bad. He just had some natural talent that you only wish of, you know. Where I think I stepped up dad's a little bit. Maybe that's questionable. But Cody would have went farther, you know. He don't know a stranger like me. He can talk to anybody. And to this day, he'll ride a motorcycle 12, 14,000 miles a year. And like I said, his arm is clear up halfway through his shoulder blade. He don't know he don't have one arm, you know. I said, Cody, I said, you know, you do a lot of things to be like their dad. A lot of people do. But for you to be left-handed like me, that would take him to extremes. He said, well, he told everybody, he said, yeah, because he always wanted the decal, tattoo. And he said, I'm so glad I never got a tattoo. He said, because my dad would have said, it looks better now.
you told me an incredible story about your grandson the other day when it comes to the military.
Oh, man. I'm so proud of this little dude. We got one grandson, one kid, so everything they do, we're proud of. But this little nut, he'll go the length of this room if he sees a veteran hat to just thank them for their service, or policemen or firemen, but mostly the military veterans. And Jody and him on July 4th. Jody and him on July 4th went to Meyer's supermarket to buy some groceries, and he seen a veteran with a veteran hat. And he ran this guy down at the end of the aisle, and he said, sir, and he shakes her hand, he said, I'd like to thank you for your service. And this veteran never batted an eye, never hesitated, and he said, son, you were worth it. I thought, oh my God, what the greatest comeback ever in the world, you know? And so that was just an awesome deal. And the guy just looked at him and said, man, he said, you were worth it. I thought, great. Jody, she started crying. It took the hair up on my arms. But yeah, it was great. And so proud of him.
And then went you with another police officer a little bit later on?
Yeah, we went to Maryland, and he went up to the police officer and asked him, and he asked him, well, why would you do something to be this aggravated? He said, because of you guys, you know. So people know that the kids today is what's going to keep this world going. It's just right now these college kids and high school kids are getting a little iffy on it now, but they'll come good in the end.
So you and I talked about YouTube and social media and stuff, and when you were racing, there was never anything like YouTube or Facebook or any of those sort of things. And so now a lot of that old video footage is resurfacing. And if you click into your name on YouTube, something comes up a little bit more than you would like. Keep moving to what apparently stands for, although I think we all know it's a little different. When I asked you about that, I thought you would laugh. But you expressed to me that kind of doesn't make you feel that great that you think that people of the modern generation, that's going to be your legacy, that little interview where you were a little aggrieved with that official.
I'm going to prove it to you. Can you tell me one race I won?
Silver Crown Race, Springfield.
Okay. Whoa, well, that's one. Now you pulled it out, you know. But I tell you, when I finish racing, when I'm gone, the only thing people can remember by me is my interview, the interview with Danny Laycock about the flagman and it making Illinois, you know. And you all know what it's like when you're mad. You don't always think what you're saying. But you gotta understand, my mouth's a little more lethal than that. And when it came out, that was the first time I heard it too. It's one of them old shit moments, but you already said it, so what are you gonna say?
So, did you ever make him?
We had a roast at Eldora about 8 years ago, and we had one of those barbecue aprons, you know, like the guys. I don't cook at all. But anyway, it had a towel sewed across the top, and if you picked the towel up to wipe your face off with the sweat, it had a humongous penis because it was on a fish bowl. And I said, tonight, I said, you know, I said, I told you he's going to kiss my, you know what? I said, tonight is the night. You know? And we think it was good fun. That's the way we do. And we both laugh about it now. And the only thing that was good is I went to the bad side of the grandstands because the other side had the steps, and if it wouldn't have been that, it wouldn't have been an interview, I'd have been in jail, because I'd have choked him. I would have choked him, you know? And he turned around, here this little fat shithead is. He's got his arms crossed, turns his back on me, I'm reaching for him, and he points for me to go back to the pit. Now here this little dude, he's going to tell me to go back to the pit, and I'm mad. And Bill Curry, he's the USAC guy, and he don't want to grab me, but he don't want no fight or nothing like that. And we're in front of the whole grandstands. And he said, if you say one more word, he said, $50. Well, $350 he put down. He never did find me, luckily. And, like I said, and then it was over, but not forgotten. Yeah.
Tell me about when you rang your dad to tell you that you'd won the Marlboro Grand National in Australia?
Yeah. They had the biggest race at the time over there. Now, they had the Warrnambool Classic with sprint cars, but but I think the Marlboro was actually bigger than that. And it's a pavement stock car race. Well, I won it. Ronnie Combs helped me set the car up and everything. And anyways, we won the race down there. And it's, I don't know, 11, 12 o'clock, which is 7 or 8 o'clock in Ohio. And I called him up. Well, my dad's best friend owned the bar, so every morning that's where he would go down for coffee. Now, my dad would drink beer, too. And I called out and said, Dad, what are you doing? I said, I'm just drinking my coffee. I said, well, go ahead and drink it. I said, get a beer. I said, we just won the Marlboro Grand National, the biggest race down here. So I get home, and my dad's buddy Jeff owns the bar. I said, Jeff, I said, I know Dad was drinking that day. How much do I owe you? He said, $168. With that, and that's when beer was 50 cents a bottle. So we bought the Cody's beer all day long.
What was Australia like for you?
It was fantastic. You know, the first 4 years I went over, it's big time wrestling in a race car, which they don't tell you any of this. Because I got on the USA Coca-Cola team, four Americans against four Australians. And I mean, they would hate you so bad. They would spit on you, throw stuff at you, and everything. But soon the race is over, they want your autograph. They want you to come down to the barbecue and be the best of friends, you know. But that's how, you know, Mike Raymond was the best promoter down there, I guess. Even over here, he would compete. But he always did commercial, and he said, it's war. I say war, you know. And it showed the Civil War guys fighting. And that's how they promoted it down there. But it's for show, it's not for fun. Now, you crash my race car, it's not fake no more. You know, that's important. I'm going to live down there. They're heroes if they crash you or if they beat you. Well, they couldn't hardly beat it, so they crashed through the lot, and we did get in a few fights down there, you know. We got one down there over in Perth on the Western Australia. The night before, this guy cut clear across the corner of the racetrack. It's all grassy and field, no car down there, nothing. Beautiful racetrack. There are 23,000 people there. And he cut the cross, he drove me up on the fence, rung my bell pretty good. Piece of my race car, the fiberglass brakes, flied back in this Benny Ludlow's car. This was Tony DiNicola did this to me. Well, piece of it falls in Benny Ludlow's car. So he's going around the track, not knowing if I'm hurt or not, waving this piece of fiberglass like, you know, Jack the Giant Killer. So the next night we go to the racetrack, we get our car fixed, we're good to go. So I'm walking down to the Tar race car hauler and everything, and I pass Benny Lolo's pit area. And he comes up and wants to talk to me like nothing's wrong. I just popped him in the nose. I just popped him, you know. It wasn't like I tried to hurt him or knock him out, but I popped him. And walk on down to my trailer, you know, just don't talk to me. So then we get down in front and they interview the four Americans and the four Australians. Well, they do the Americans first because we're the guests. And I get up there and I said, you know, I told them how chicken shit I thought all their drivers was. And they're booing me. I mean, trying to get out of people, a lot of people. And they're booing me and everything. So I finally finished talking and I'm standing back in line. Well, Tony DiNicola is the first Australian to get interviewed. So he comes back to me and I said, now, Tony, if you think tonight's going to be like last night, you're mistaken. And he said, you don't know. And he started, and I went to the ground with my fist, and I drilled him. I mean, and now he's on the ground on his hands and knees, which is pretty bad. But if his head was a football, it would run 60 yards. He now he's spread eagle in the grass. And about 30 guys come after me. I just sidestepped them and settled on the back of the pickup truck. And we went out and won the feature that night. And then the cops had to take us back to the hotel. But it was still going. And then after we left town, they have a Hungry Jack over there. They don't have Burger King. Same thing, but they're not allowed to use the name. And the Jimmy Hosler, who makes the tack for the late model and the sprint, and my buddy Nick Wynn was with me. Well, I know what I want. I don't have to go in the restaurant and look for the menu. I can get it, and I get out. So now I'm sitting in the car. And you know how you always drop french fries at the bottom of the bag? Well, I'm reaching down trying to find the french fries at the bottom of the bag. And man, next thing I know, he popped me upside the head. Broke my sunglasses and everything, had them on. I thought, damn, Nick, you're playing a little rough. I'm pissed. Well, I jumped out of the car and there's four of them there. And they got me down to one knee. And I got up and out. I mean, we're parked at the side of 100 yet. I run around. I didn't go in. No, that's too smart. I beat on the window. Well, Jimmy Hauser's a little skinny thing. He couldn't have paid him to come up. My buddy, he's not too smart either. He came out to help me. Now I'm two in four. Well, two of them, well, one of them grabbed him from behind, and then I got the guy that hit me. I got him on the ground. One guy's pulling us by my hair, and I had a head full of it then. And then another guy trying to put a PF flyer sticker on my forehead for kicking me in the head. And I got a little cut between my eyes and my glasses. My shirt ripped a little bit. And I get back, and I'm standing looking at these guys, and they say, you're nothing but a girl. I thought I did rather well, you know. I mean, it might not have been a victory, but it sure wasn't a bad loss. So they said, well, you leave town, and don't you ever come back to Perth. Well, we went back to stay three more days. And then Tony and I were racing the following year, and I said, you know, he said, hey, are you over all this? I said, they're not going to have a problem with you. I said, but I'd sure like to see your brother and his buddy. Oh, he said, just forget it. Forget it all. That one time we got into it at the racetrack. You know what, Tom?
Well, I was really trying to tell you through what a beautiful country I live in, but that's okay. I didn't want to talk
about that. But it's a woman, and Wollongong. They turn around, and what they do, they start two abreast. We never did that very often on restarts. So we ended up, well, if it was down the inside, you could pass cars. If you're on the outside, you lose position. Well, they kept having restart after restart for the feature, the final event, which was a points deal. And anyway, they got to where we was on the outside, so they went to first and second, which made us third and fourth, and there's eight cars in the race. Well, they turned around, and so now they got the lead in the points. Well, now they had another yell. Oh, we're not going to go two abreast again. We're going single file, which made them win. So I'm riding around the whole racetrack, flipping everybody off. And they're cheering, and they're all happy. And I like that I'm a racer. I'm not a showman. And we turn around, and I get out, and I say a few choice words. So then we're back in the pits, and I finally get all calmed down. And anyway, this guy comes up to me and starts giving me the ride. Who do you think you are? Well, come over here and tell us how to run our race. And all. Well, I hit him. Now my brother and his other mechanic, he got me over on the ground by the fence holding me. Well, this girl hold off and hit me in the mouth. And my mom, now lady, I don't take this offense, but my mom always taught me, if a woman hits like a man, she takes a beating like a man. That's the way I was brought up, and I don't mean to be mean or nothing like that. I'm looking for that bitch. I'm mad again. And you know, I seen her come walking through the pits. And man, I took off at a dead run. And some little old sweet lady was down there with her programs and her blanket. And then the cinder. They weren't rock, they were cinders. And I mean, I flew over top of her and I skinned myself all up and knocked her down. I'm helping her with her programs and her blanket. I felt so bad. So then this other guy that I hit during the fight somehow, he was 300 pounds, he's a big boy. But I'm still mad, luckily. And he said, and the guy that we stayed with in that town, he knew him, he knew who he was. So he said, well, I walked right up to him, you know, I don't care. And he said, all I know is somebody hit me in the mouth, and he's got to pay for it. I thought, tell you what I'm going to do, Porky. I said, let's me and you walk over to the racetrack, or the horse track. I said, because I don't want no son of a gun here breaking this fight up. It's just going to be me and you. All I did was create a little doubt. I didn't save my life or nothing. But so, anyways, we had all come. The cops show up. Well, as soon as the cops show up, I just get in the back seat. What are you doing? I said, you come here after me? I just got another car. Get out of my car, they said. So they threw me over the cop car. It all got carried square away that night. No problem. Nobody went to jail. Nobody got hurt. The next year we went back to Wollongong, and this guy just stands in front of my race car for a long time, staring at me, giving me a dirty look. Now I'm not mad anymore, and he's big. So I told Nick, that's the guy. Well, what are you going to do about that? I don't know what you're going to do about that. I'm going to run. But I can't. I'm taking ass with him first. So finally I walked up to him and said, you're still not mad about last year, are you? And he said, make a fist. Evidently, he is still mad. So anyway, I made a fist, and he took that big old hand and just covered my little hand. He said, I can't believe anything so little can hit so hard. He said. And he sat there and just bullshitted all night long.
Welcome back, Tony. You haven't missed a thing. We're just telling him all the Australians that he's fought in the last few years. So,
come on, very nice. Thank you.
Thanks, mate. I appreciate that. Terry McCarl was telling me a very funny story. Just a few weeks ago during Nationals, John McCoy, who is a race director here, he keeps a very tight ship here. I don't know how he would have dealt with you back in the day, John. What would you have done with a guy fighting like that in your period?
Got a big 300-pound guy.
Yeah. So Terry McCarl, was it Tony Morrow, wasn't it?
Wait a minute, he brought up another story before he gets in the van. Steve Butler crashed me. Now, Steve Butler is my buddy, but he crashed me twice. Now, when you got your helmet on, that's all void, your friendship deal. And he crashed me for the second time, and he come down to my car, and I hit him. He got up and I hit him again. Well, now his wife's pregnant, she gets in between it. So I'm calm down there, everything's cool. Raleigh Bill comes up, he's ready to kill me because he's the competition director. Come Monday, Roger McCluskey called me up. He said, Jack, he said, you know we got a $500 fine for fighting. Yeah, I do. He said, you know you can't race again until you pay it. I said, I know the rules, Roger. Well, he said, are you going to pay it? I said, no, I'm going to Ward Outlaw racing. So how about if I put you under a $500 bond? If you do it again, it's going to cost you cash. I said, I'll do that.
So Terry was telling me, Tony Morrow and Terry were getting into it during, it was actually hot laps, I think, in the infield. And I look over, I'm standing with Jack Hordeschild, and these two are boxing on. And I said, wow, Jack, why aren't you over there doing that? He goes, hold on. It's for the big boys. I said, you know, I've always wondered who would win out of a fight between Terry McCarl and Jack Hewitt. And he goes, they did fight. In the rain.
In the mud.
So I got told the story that Leonard McCarl made Terry go down. He said, you can't end like this. You've got to go back down and fight Jack. Terry corrected me. You guys were nowhere together in the B main. He's all over the track. You're 6th and 7th. You're not going to make the show.
We're there together. We're not far apart. We're right together. And he was running into my race car, and I looked at him. So did he. So it wasn't like he went down and jumped on some little kid like a hod. Well, we ended up arguing, and I hit him. I went back to my pit. I got cut you off because I can't handle the wrong way. So we turned around and went back to my pit. And Terry come down, and he said, Jack, he said, it can't end this way. I thought, all right, I said, but here's the deal. We're going to walk down together. We're going to walk back together. You know, whoever wins or loses, it makes no difference. We're going down behind the truck or whatever and come back. But just as we get down there, it starts pouring down rain. So, you know, I'm wanting to kind of stand up. Well, Terry's more on the ground kind of guy. And so we get on the ground. Now this lightweight's got his thumb in my eye. And it's like that we're in the mud and the rain, so we couldn't hurt anybody, each other, if we wanted to. But he did put my, he got a little scratch on my eye right there. That was the worst the whole night was. And anyway, we got broke up and walked back to our race car together. And the next year we was in Illinois at Wyland or something like that racetrack. And so I went down and apologized to Terry because, you know, I was probably my fault. And Leonard, he's standing, he said, I should have kicked both your boys, bud, he said, you know, like that. Well, then I started driving the Maxim House car, and we was going over to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, the race. Well, and it was Doug Doss and Leonard, or Tim Clark and Leonard. Terry and I was riding in the truck. And anyway, Terry told me, he said, you know, he said, Jack, he said, I didn't mind the fight. And he said, you know, I do fight. And he said, but the worst thing, he said, I walked down to the trailer. There you are, sitting in a lawn chair. And I say, Jack, it's not going to end here. He said, you know, we got to finish it. He said, I thought you had a spring in your ass. He said, you jumped up and said, yeah. And we'll walk down together and we'll walk back together. He said, you could at least hesitate. And that was just something to laugh about.
So Terry told
now
me.
You can tell it the wrong way.
Oh, thank you. So Terry told me this 4 days ago, okay, that you come down to his pit, and he didn't realize at the time, he was only a kid, what that meant. when you arrived in his pit, that meant someone's going to get punched. That's probably going to be him. So you delivered the message and you went back. And Leonard said to Terry, you know, you're becoming a man. This is a man's world. This is going to happen every now and again. Terry said, Dad, it can't end like this. I need to go back down. So Leonard said, you're right. And he grabbed his teeth and pulled his teeth out and said, let's go down there. So he said, he came up to you and said, it can't end like this. We got to fight. And you said, no, let's just go over there. That's like a good spot. And Terry went, jeez. He was actually hoping you'd go, no, it's all right, man. We're all good and done. He said, you went, how does that spot work for you over there? So he said he didn't want you to say, yeah, let's get after it.
He did. He liked the fight, dude. And then he's got his dad instigating. So, you know, when you got Leonard around, there's not a whole lot of choice. But, like, the author is today's story. Danny Smith, we took him out when he was 16 and got him drunk over in a triangle bar in the Ohio. And so, Danny and I are pretty good friends. And at Eldora one year, at an all star race, he told Joe Gurdy and Tom Wimmer, he said, man, Jack's running the crap out of Nitro tonight. He said, I couldn't see. I won the feature. And I'm happy with it and proud of it, you know. But Danny said, you know, I was running Nitro. And he was wrong. And I'm pissed at Danny now. So we go down to the Talladega Short Track down in Alabama. And Danny comes right over to my pits. I said, Danny, get out of my pits. And he said, you know, well, we talked. We got to a little pushing in. We hit him. And I got him down on the ground, and we're underneath Joey Nash's race car. He's down there changing gears, and Danny's like down there fighting on the other side of the car. And anyway, they get broke up, and we go and race that night and everything. And that night after the feature, he calls his wife Beth up. And she said, well, how did you do tonight? Well, he said, I ran fourth in the feature. He said, but I got in a fight. And she said, well, who with? He said, Hewitt. I don't know. She said, how bad are you? Yeah, you should have snatched her. Everything we did, we got into it. We never held a grudge. You never. Sammy and I got into it a couple times, but Sammy, my buddy and I helped Sammy down at Riverside one night, you know. So it's nothing that you hold a grudge with forever or nothing like it. The biggest one was everybody said I hit Amy, and I never in my life touched Amy Swindell. I wouldn't have thought of it, you know, but. The story went around for years that I ended up hitting her and I didn't.
Can you believe it's been an hour? You know the beautiful part about you, Jack, is that you take us back to a time when life was so much more simple. When people didn't get offended by someone using the wrong word at the wrong time. Where people just loved the pure beauty of watching someone run the top. And love someone who was going to let you know if they weren't happy, then the deal was done, let's get on with it, let's go racing again. You never ever mince words. You don't have a filter. You have this incredible lady sitting over the back that she almost lost you to Florence Henderson. You were almost in the Brady Bunch.
Close to the Brady Bunch at Henderson. She liked old Jackie Boy. She's proud of there, you know. Ladies, now whatever you do, I don't want to offend you. Please don't take this offensive, but this is my mouth. It's at the golf tournament. They don't allow you, you know, we're at Indianapolis at the driver tournament. There's 400 people there. Dennis Woods is the MC who, at the time, owner was managing Phoenix International. And he told me, he said, Jack, what do you think about becoming the oldest rookie to make the Indianapolis Motor Speedway? And I said, well, any time that you win an award in Indianapolis or have a title, it's pretty cool. It's some kind of record. It's good to have at that speedway. But I said, you know, I said, I really feel bad because I beat Lynn St. James. I said, now she lost that and she didn't make the race, and I felt bad she didn't make the race. Well, Dennis Wood knew I didn't care much for women race car drivers at that time. They hadn't proven herself yet. Now, they're different, but back then, they just got there because they were a woman. And he said, well, what do you mean? I said, well, by Lynn St. James missing the show, I said, that makes me the only driver in the field with a mustache. So Brian Barnhouse come up, and he said, Jack, you're not an Indian at Eldora, you're an Indian at Eldora. You can't say things like that. Well, I said, Brian, I said, I cleaned it up.
He was so close to safely back on the tarmac there.
And he said, well, and the dummy says, what do you mean? So then, I mean, I won't repeat that part, you know, but I was talking about that whole thing for Roberto Guerrero. I said, Lynn St. James missed the show. That makes Roberto Guerrero something else in the field, you know. So then he didn't talk to me the rest of the month. I knew that was bad. And then the best one, though, that got me the most credit. Nobody knows where I finished it in here, very few, but every time something happened, the press was way down in my pit area. You know, here's Ryan Dyke. Boy, all these guys are there. But they always come down to my pits because I don't candy coat stuff. Well, all these reporters are. Jody and I walked around the corner. All the reporters are at their garage. They said, well, what do you think about Line Day? Well, I don't know. What do you think?
Hold it. Can we turn off the Facebook Live? not yet. Tell the rest of the story.
Just.
Go ahead, Jack. Please come back next year anyway.
Yeah, wait a minute, he just can't help it. I'm not giving him a microphone. But anyway, if I can't go to Able Sound. Anyway, he said, well, what do you mean? And he said, well, Line Dyke badmouthed two rookies. I said, man, I do care what that bag of things. They printed it. It wasn't no big deal. I didn't mean nothing personal. I didn't comment all it was. So anyway, we go to Loudon, and Ari's there, and he said, I want to talk to you after the driver's meeting. Well, I don't care. I like to race and fight. They don't make me do that. He didn't want to fight. So then, we go to Indianapolis for the 100-year anniversary, and Jody and I go there. Well, Fernelli Jones is sitting right there, and he was my hero, and I wanted to talk to him. Line Dyke and his son that's already sitting there with his boy are standing up. And I went over to be nice, you know. I mean, he shouldn't be mad anymore. It's been a few years. And I went to shake his hand, and he wouldn't shake my hand. He fist bumped me. Oh, I was pissed. I was pissed. I mean, if you can't shake my hand, don't waste your time or effort, you know. So I said, well, here, Ari. I said, this is my wife, Jody. And guess what he does? He shakes her hand. I said, you know what was in her hand 2 hours ago? So he turned around after that and he looked at the boy and he was laughing. And he says, now this here's the guy that called me a European faggot. I said, all right. I said, I didn't call you no European. And we hung around for the rest of the weekend and had a ball.
Jody has some of the posters that my friend from Australia, who lives in Canada, he did a beautiful job, Jack, of all your cars and a great shot of you with the black Mo back then as well. I'd love you to stop by and buy one if you want. For $20, Jack will sign it for you. I'm so blessed to sit next to a man like this and do this because, mate, you make everybody's lives better. I cannot thank you enough. The one and only Jack Hewitt.
You gotta have people to watch, and without you guys being there, it wouldn't have been worth anything.
Thank you, Jack.